Good morning. I am Jensana Sumail from Computer Science Department. Today my topic is about spread spectrum and its type. Next, going into the definition of spread spectrum. Spread spectrum is a form of wireless transmission in which the transmitted signal can have a frequency that can be deliberately varied. In other words, the bandwidth of the signal is having a greater extent, or in other words, you can say the advantage is going to avoid the narrowband interference. As in this diagram, see, we see the narrowband signal which is getting converted into the spread spectrum signal, and it is getting spread over a large frequency range. And this is what the spread spectrum technique is about. Next, seeing about the different steps in which the user has to spread the signal. First of all, we receive an idealized narrowband signal. The user then is going to convert this narrowband signal into the broadband signal. The energy needed to transfer the signal is the same, whereas the frequency is going to be spread over a large range. At the receiving side, the sum of the interference plus the broadband interference as well as narrowband interference is getting received. The receiver will now know the way to de-spread the signal. In other words, it's going to convert the narrowband interference into the broadband interference, whereas leaving the broadband interference. At the receiving end, a pass filter is also applied. The pass filter is going to cut the frequencies, unnecessary frequencies that are present in the left and right of the signal, and the resultant reconstructed signal is got. The diagram shows how the spread spectrum is carried out. The user signal is given as input, and in which spreading is performed, that is, the narrowband signal is converted into a broadband signal. In the next step, the interference is getting added, that is the narrowband interference as well as broadband interference. At the receiving side, the receiver has to know how to de-spread, and de-spreading means it is allowing the broadband interference but converting the narrowband interference into the broadband interference, and a bandpass filter is used to cut the unnecessary interference signals. And finally, we obtain the necessary original signal, that is a constructed signal. Next, going into the way in which spreading is done for different channels. For example, we consider here there are 6 different channels. Here, each and every channel has its own capacity for transferring the signal. For example, 4 and 6 channels may not be of good quality, in which case the signal cannot reach the destination. So in this case, a narrowband interference will avoid the signal from the channel 4 and 6. So in order to avoid this drawback, we go into the spread spectrum technique, in which all the narrowband signals is getting converted into the broadband signal. So after conversion at the receiving end, the receiver has to apply the CDM technique, or it has to know the code for decoding, then only it can recover the signal. So this is very useful for military application where secret information is getting transferred. So this is the main advantage. It's also used in the US mobile phone system. Next, going to the disadvantage of using the spread spectrum is, the spread spectrum is a very complex task in which the receiver has to know the way in which it has to de-spread the signal. And secondly, since the frequency is very large, it is very difficult to handle. And the next drawback is that there is a background noise that is present. And next, we go into the two types of spread spectrum. That is, first one is direct sequence spread spectrum, and second one is frequency hopping spread spectrum. Going to the direct sequence spread spectrum, here the user debit data is going to be exclusively odd with that of a chipping sequence. So chipping sequence is a pseudo-random sequence, which is a random noise that is getting generated, and the result is a signal which is of the same sequence if the user bit is 0 and its complement if the user bit is a 1. Here the spreading factor or the bandwidth is given by the formula S is equal to TB by TC. Where TB means the duration of the bit, and TC means the chipping sequence duration. So if an input signal is of W bandwidth, then the resulting spread signal would be of bandwidth S into W. So for everyday applications, we use a spread factor which is less than 7, And when we consider for civil applications, it may range from a spread factor between 10 and 100. And for military applications, it may range up to 10,000 also. So instead of using the code for checking sequence, here we use a Barker coder. Why we are using Barker code means it will avoid all the interference that is going to be present. In other words, it's going to prevent the interference for us. So the next is the what is the transmitter has to do with this. So here the main important component of the DSS is the DSS transmitter and the DSS receiver. So DSS transmitter, first of all, it's going to have a component for exclusively or the chipping sequence with the user bit signal. This is the first step in the digital modulation, and which is followed by the radio modulation. That is, this signal is going to be transferred into a spread signal, and it is the sender side operation. And at the receiving side also, there is some operation which is getting carried out. In the receiving side, the receiver has to despread the signal by again doing an exclusive OR of the chipping sequence with that of the spread spectrum signal that is getting demodulated. And finally, an integrator is used to find the sum of all the products of all the user signals. And finally, a decision map is going to be there in order to map the user signal to a binary 1 or binary 0. In this way, the original data is getting constructed in a DSS. So the diagram, in the diagram, we see the same steps. First of all, the user data is performing an exclusive OR operation with that of the chipping sequence, and it is given as input to a modulator, and that is acting as a spread spectrum signal, which is coming as output. And at the receiving side also, the same signal is getting received, the spread spectrum is getting its output by the means of demodulation. So once after demodulation, it is again doing an exclusive OR with that of the signal, and then finally the integrated sum as well as the decision map is going to be performed. Next, we see one example for doing this DSS operation. We take a user bit, for example, 01, in which the Barker code is given like this: 10110, 111000. So by exclusing OR with 0 with this Barker code and again 1 with this Barker code, so we obtain this following sequence. That is, if it is 0 means, so 0 means the same sequence is going to be repeated again. And if it is a user bit is 1 means, the sequence is getting complemented. So this is the output of the DSS transmitter. So next, at the receiving side, if you see, the resulting signal from the transmitter side is again doing an exclusive OR with that of the Barker code. Then after doing this, we are achieving a signal, and we find the sum of products of this particular signal. We found that the sum of products is 0 for the first one, and the sum of products is equal to 11 for the second one. So the decision unit will now sample this output. That is, it's going to map for us the 0 output as 1, the 0 output as binary 0, and 11 output as a binary 1. So there may be a special situation in which the demodulated signal is getting distorted. In other words, the bits are getting changed, and that is received at the receiving side. So when it is coming like that, the decision unit is also able to map this type of situations. For example, if the sum is 2 and the second sum is 10, it will map for a sum which is less than 10 and which is sum which is greater than 7. Like that, it can map. And still the decision can be made perfect. Then next is the concept of the rake receiver, where we use N correlators. In this case, N strongest paths are found out, and the sum of all these correlators is given as input to the integrator, which is then fed into the decision unit for reconstruction of the signal. Next type of spread spectrum is frequency hopping spread spectrum. In this type, the entire bandwidth is going to be divided into small bandwidth of many channels. And the main advantage here is, so the frequency is getting hopped from one place to another. So the fast frequency hopping can prevent the interference also. So there are two possible cases here. First one is a slow hopping and next one is fast hopping. Before that, we have to know what is dwell time. Dwell time is what the transmitter and receiver takes in a particular channel. It's the amount of time that is spent by the transmitter and receiver in a particular time for a certain period. So that is called dwell time. What is meant by hopping sequence means the hopping sequence decides the period of change from one channel to another channel. So when we consider the definition for slow hopping, the slow hopping means the same frequency is retained for several bit periods. And in the case of fast hopping, the frequency is frequently changing from one frequency to another for the same bit period. So the same frequency will not be maintained for the entire bit period. Going to the block diagram of the FHS. So here the input data is getting modulated by one of the modulation schemes. It can be digital to analog conversion, we can say, using BPSK or QPSK modulations. Here the output is given as analog signal or narrowband signal is getting fed into a modulator, and there is also a frequency synthesizer. What's the main aim of this frequency synthesizer is the frequency synthesizer will store all the hopping sequences and it will output a carrier frequency. So the carrier frequency plus the narrowband signal together will be given as input to the modulator, which will give the resultant spread signal. At the receiving side, demodulation is going to take place. So here, again, the inverse operation of the modulation, that is demodulation, is getting performed, and the result is the reconstructed original signal. Next, we will see how to compare this DSS with FSS. So when in comparison we see, so FSS is a very simple one and DSS is not like that. So here, when we consider security issue and multipath propagation, it is resistant to, in the case of DSS, but not in the case of FHS. And DSS is much harder to detect, and this is regarding the comparison. So I conclude that learning is a very good job. That is that we should learn more and more, and we should learn and lead. Thank you for giving me this opportunity.